So I am Garrick Tabassi. I am a co-founder of Mindtrip, and I think more importantly, I'm standing between you and lunch. So I have just a tight 90 minutes, and if we all cooperate, we'll get out of here. Just kidding. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what we're doing at Mindtrip with regards to multimodal inputs. And spoiler alert, I will not be talking much about the cool new real-time API. We've been doing some prototyping with that, and I'll comment on that at the end. But mainly, I'm going to talk about all the great stuff you can do with the API you already know and love, Chat Complete. All right, so let's dive in. First of all, what the heck is Mindtrip? So Mindtrip is your AI-powered travel platform, and we have this ambitious goal to help you with the full travel life cycle, whether it's inspiration and discovery, planning, collaborating with other travelers, booking, and then on the trip, et cetera. So this is a big, expansive vision. And this is my one marketing slide. My CMO will be happy that I included it. It also represents the peak production value of the whole deck. So it's all downhill from here. But what really are we talking about? When we started ideating around travel, we started, as many people did, with ChatGPT. And believe me, I love ChatGPT, use it all the time. But when you're doing travel planning, you're left with, you know, inert text. You know, it kind of leaves you right at the altar. You can't really plan the trip, you can't really action it. And so I think with a lot of LLM-based applications, the challenge is how do you take that inert text and make it actionable and alive? And so with Mindtrip, we're able to connect entities in the conversation, put it on a map, et cetera. We've got photos, we've got reviews, bada boom, bada bing. By the way, does this look a little familiar? Right, that Wanderlust demo. So just for the record, we were there first. They saw an early demo of this and then asked if we didn't mind if they'd do a little thing in DevDay a year ago. So that's pretty cool. So a lot of what we're doing is taking the text, making it alive and actionable. Okay, that's great. We then looked a lot at how when people start the travel planning journey, where they get that inspiration from. And it turns out there's lots of great content on the internet that can kind of kickstart travel planning. But again, we see the same problem. There's a lot of inert, unactionable content. So whether it's like a blog post or a travel article, or whether it's a long form video or short form social video, or even just an inspirational image, we want to make it so any of these can be kind of the seed crystal for, you know, useful, vibrant travel planning. And so now it's time to bust out of the deck and do a quick demo. So here I am in Mindtrip with a blank conversation. Let's say that I stumble on this cool blog post where someone is talking about this really interesting island. It's part of Portugal, but it's in the middle of the Atlantic. And so I can just go to Mindtrip and say, hey, plan me a trip based on chugga, chugga, chugga. And what we'll get is a faithful representation of that itinerary and that article, kind of in a structured form. We've got things on the map. Let's see where the cool cave is. So there's the cool cave. You can see we've got a trip that we've drafted up for you so you can kind of mess with that. And it's all kind of ready to rock. So that's interesting. But the observant audience member will notice we haven't done anything multimodal. We're still in the wheelhouse of the LLM text. All right. So let's try something maybe a little more interesting. Let's say instead of having this blog post, let's say someone sent me an image or I stumbled on an image on the internet, and I'm just gonna copy and paste this. You know, you could upload, drag, drop. But let's say I start with this, and now I've got, again, a fresh thing, and I say, I want to go to there. That is a 30 Rock reference for those of you that are in the right demographic. And so here we're sending the image straight to GPT-4.0. Did you know you can do that? Just send it right over. And no PhDs necessary. I've now got out of the box some interpretation of that image. And I've got some cool stuff cooking there. So that's images, cool. What about videos? So videos come in different shapes and sizes, and I think you can tell I'm a pretty cool, hip, young guy. And so I love me some snack-sized social videos, you know, often heavily caption-based with like a boozy soundtrack in the background. So I've got one of those right here for you. So for example, here's some. Yeah, that's put me in the mood to travel. So this is some recommendations around London. So I can go in here and say, plan me a trip based on Recos. And we will recognize that it's London and start plotting those things on the map. And again, we're putting together a draft itinerary. So that's all pretty sweet. And let's kind of maybe dive under the hood and talk about that, go back to the deck. So first off, just to be super clear, the Chat Complete API has two data types, image and text. And so if you have images you're dealing with, it's worth kind of asking yourself, what is the semantic value of the image? If it's visual, like in the case of that cool cave, then you probably just want to send it straight into a GPT-4.0. If what you have is text content in the image, you may want to do a separate pass, like a side conversation to kind of do the OCR, and then send that resulting text for final answer generation. Videos are a little trickier since videos are obviously not a native type supported directly by the model. So you've got to do some shenanigans. You've got to decide, again, what semantic value you can extract from the video. If you have a high value audio transcript, you can get that audio transcript, maybe strip it off the video with FFmpeg, and you can use a speech to text API like we use OpenAI's Whisper model, their speech to text API. That works great. Now you've got text, now you can work with that. You may also have a video that just has purely visual content, in which case you've got to decide how you want to sample frames. You can extract those with something like FFmpeg, send those to the model. Or in the case of that social video, if it's text captions, now you got to figure out how to sample frames and do OCR on it and send it over to the resulting text over to the model. Operationally, just some minor details, which may be self-evident. When you send images to the model, you can either give it a URL or you can do it inline as kind of a data URL. We host them on S3 and send in a URL. And then if you're doing any kind of post-processing, like speech to text or OCR, you know, you can cache those, which means if you've got a piece of content that's a little, you know, hot, then you know, you save a little money, you reduce latency for users, which of course you know, is win-win. And then finally, a couple thoughts. So we have had a chance to play with the new real-time API, which is pretty awesome, and it's a very different shape of API. But that's because it's really a different beast, because you want to support that real-time, and in particular, the semantics around doing interruption, which is kind of an interesting challenge. So that's pretty cool. We're excited about that. And maybe from the demo you saw earlier, you might imagine the kinds of things we would do in our product around real-time audio. But for us, using images and kind of the existing multimodal capabilities, that helps us connect inspiration with action and booking. And I think just in general, it's worth thinking about whatever your application domain is. Is there existing content in the ecosystem that you can leverage to kind of get the conversation started, so you aren't just putting people in either pre-canned prompts or, you know, kind of the blinking cursor, the blank page phenomenon? So those are just a few thoughts. Any questions, feel free to reach out to me. And thanks for your time and attention.